She's been somebody who's been handpicked by Indira Gandhi in 1969. She's worked with Sanjay Gandhi and now Sonia Gandhi. Ambika Soni has waited till she turned 71 to fight her first Lok Sabha election, clearly at a time when most of the party seniors were giving Congress tickets a miss, clearly to show that she was one with the Gandhis in this challenge of 2014. Our guest on Real Politics today, Ambika Soni. As we set off for the first public meeting of the day, let's get a sense of what this election means for Ambika Soni personally. Mrs. Ambika Soni, you've waited far too long to contest your first Lok Sabha election. You were seen as this hand-picked young politician by Indira Gandhi, and since then you've seen several summers and several seasons in Parliament. Why did you decide to contest this time?
Well, this time I had no intention of contesting because there was a young MP who had won the last time. But Congress party decided to revamp their list of candidates for Punjab specifically, given the fact that people from Punjab were constantly coming and complaining about the disconnect between the government in Punjab and the people. And thereafter, the people were suffering. So the party decided to put their best foot forward and got Amrinder Singh to contest Amritsar, and Sunil Jakhar, Manpreet Badal from Bathinda is contesting on Assembly, and me from Anandpur Sam. And I do tell you that I haven't been the face of the party in the last 5 years in this constituency, but maybe you know, I had worked very hard for the creation of this constituency and thereafter in building up the cultural heritage of this constituency, which is enormous.
But Ambika ji, somewhere or the other, several senior leaders of the Congress party opting out of the election fray, whether it was P. Chidambaram or Manish Tiwari, is that something that made you contest? Because you'd said when you moved out of the INB ministry that as far as electoral politics was concerned, you were going to call it a day.
Have you
just done this to prove a point to your detractors within the party, or those detractors who were probably not reposing as much faith in Ten Janpat as you do normally?
Well, you see, the thing is that it's not a question of proving a point. I had opted out of electoral politics because I do feel people at a certain age must create that space for the younger generation. I'm very convinced on that and I'm not going back. But it's a fact that some people opted out of the electoral politics, some people got into the upper house just on the eve of the Lok Sabha election. So there was a feeling that senior leaders are not wanting to contest. So when the Congress president rang me up and said the party wanted me to contest, I did tell her that it's going to be very difficult because I haven't been the face. And I haven't done that kind of work which is expected of a person wanting to contest. But she felt that she had other information which I didn't have access to, which was not going to be difficult for me to contest. So that's it. I didn't need much persuasion.
Do you think somewhere or the other the Congress party has left its generational transfer midway somewhere?
No.
Rahul Gandhi has been made the vice president, but when it comes to selection of candidates, you've still gone back to the old guard quite a lot.
No. I don't agree with you. It's a very good blend. I'm talking of the 13 seats in Punjab. We have two former youth
Congress. I'm talking about the country as a whole.
All right, country as a whole, but we've never said that the generational change is going to be like cut off. It's always going to be a harmonious blend. That's what a political party tries to ensure, that you have experience and seniority along with youthful enthusiasm and energy. And I think if you look at across the country,
Or do you think once again it's local candidates that will be more important?
Well, I think Narendra Modi has never been a topic of anyone's speech when I'm in the rural areas. And my constituency is predominantly a rural constituency. In urban pockets, the BJP and the Akali Dal are asking for votes in the name of Narendra Modi. He doesn't mean what Punjab associates with Narendra Modi is that his government, he and his government are literally throwing out, pushing out Punjab farmers, Punjabi farmers who have worked and slogged over the last 3-4 decades in Gujarat to create something out of Banjar Zameen, making it fertile. So they know that the attitude of the Gujarat government hasn't been favorable to the ordinary Punjabi kisan or something. So that's something which...
So Ambika Soni feels it's not going to be the Modi magic that's going to work in Punjab. In Punjab, it's the local issues which will be top priority for the voters when they go out to vote on the 30th of April. Elections in Punjab have their own color and dynamics. As she explains to audiences, she's not an outsider as propagated by her opponent from the Anandpur Sahib constituency, Prem Singh Chandumajra, who's from the Akali Dal, who has lost last three elections, the assembly elections of 2007, 2012 and a Lok Sabha one in 2009, giving the Congress a glimmer of hope that Ambika Soni could just... Ambika ji, you are in the thick of the election in Punjab. This time the Congress party has taken out the big wigs, the heavyweights to field in Punjab. Both Captain Amrinder Singh and yourself coming out. Is this the biggest challenge that the Congress has faced in Punjab? Or is it a point that the Congress party is trying to make against the Akali BJP combined?
You see, there is a very strong ground level resentment against the misrule of the Akali government in Punjab. It's been a long period of 7.5 years of unfulfilled promises, broken promises, and a total disconnect between the government and the people. Having said that, in 2012, I think what I gathered in the last 25 days of active campaigning is that people wanted to change this government even in 2012, but somewhere we faltered. We also, as a political party capable of replacing the Akalis, we faltered. And I think I explained it to the people saying that we have learned from that. We know that the people are suffering and we do want to help them. We do want to help them. And so the party leadership, the Congress president, has asked senior leaders to contest so as to instill the confidence in the people that the Congress stands united and the leadership.
But if there is a united Congress, why does this issue of the 1984 riots come back to haunt the Congress party? Is it because you target Narendra Modi with 2002, which is why 1984 comes back in the narrative of the 2014 elections? In fact, Narendra Modi has targeted the Gandhi family. In fact, he said that this is the RSVP Parivar which has been running a business. Rahul, Sonia, Vadra and Priyanka. Do you think that's the level that the Congress would want this debate to go to?
Well, whether Congress can stop that kind of debate at its own, on its own part. But we've never expected anything better from Mr. Modi. That's why I oppose him, and all of us oppose him for prime ministership, because he's only shown a street smart attitude. And you don't become the prime minister of 130 crore people by having that level of thinking and public articulation.
Do you think this targeting of the Gandhi family, especially Priyanka and Robert Vadra, is a result of the fact that the Congress also targeted, Rahul Gandhi raised the issue of the marital status of Narendra Modi in a speech on the stage?
I'm sorry, Navika. Now you're really touching a very sensitive chord as far as I'm concerned. The marital status of Mr. Narendra Modi was unknown to all Indians. Though he has fought several elections, we are supposed to declare the assets of those who are married to us, men or women. And we've never heard of a spouse. And I think as a woman and as a person who's been actively involved for women's empowerment, I don't buy what he said, that he married and then one fine morning told his wife that I am going to work for the party, fend for yourself, and didn't look back. That's not fair. That's not on. And I think because elections are going on, enough importance, enough space in media has not been given to those activists who really feel very strongly about what he did. And you take out full pages of advertisements costing crores of rupees on behalf of Mr. Modi, talking of empowerment of women. With what moral...
Two specific instances that happened over the last 24 hours. One is Praveen Togadia saying that in Bhavnagar, anybody who is staying in a Hindu locality, Muslims should vacate that place. That's one part of the narrative that we heard yesterday. And then a Shiv Sena MP on the dais sharing the stage with Narendra Modi said that any Muslims who misbehave will be taken care of. Do you think that discourse is something that is going to be the real hallmark of the elections of 2014?
You know, if I'm not saying that it's going to happen like this in this election, but if there was a referendum in this country, if there was a referendum in this country on the utterances of Togadia and the Shiv Sena fellow, you would be surprised that they would lose hands down when the ordinary man is asked to give a vote. Because the ordinary Indian citizen is secular. Whenever there have been riots between any two communities, it's always the neighbors who've chipped in and helped. That shows the secular nature of the Indian citizen.
We'll slip into a short break, but coming up after the break, we will discuss with Ambika Soni what she feels about Priyanka Gandhi getting into politics. For the Congress party, it is a do or die battle as far as the elections of 2014 are concerned. In Punjab, there is the question of the 1984 riots, which has been brought up every now and then. On the other hand, in the rest of the country, a huge anti-incumbency wave against the Congress party. Will leaders like Ambika Soni, who've jumped into the fray to prove a point to the leadership of the Congress party, have a future after the elections of 2014? That's the big test for them.